This is the second in a two-part video series that addresses the reconciliation process districts are required to complete every January. This video will work through five more complex examples of what districts might find during their reconciliation process. Before watching this video, we encourage listeners to have first reviewed the Lesson 6 video, which shows how to reconcile probably two easier groups of students, those enrolling after the third Friday in September and those enrolling before or on the third Friday in September, but withdrawing before the second Friday in January. We recommend all districts start the reconciliation process by working with new enrollee early withdrawal information, as most of the changes will be explained by these two reasons. So let's assume we have submitted our January PI 1563 membership report, found the reconciliation spreadsheet on the DPI School Financial Services website, saved it to our local computer, opened it, pulled down our district to load the data, and verified that the student numbers and categories we are seeing in columns 1 and 5 of the spreadsheet match exactly what is in the summary table in the School Financial Services Reporting Portal, Sapphire, for these two reports for our district. You will want to be sure to do all this prep work so that you know you are looking at the exact data DPI has on record. So in this reconciliation example, notice that the total September resident pupil count in column 1 is 470, and the total January resident pupil count in column 5 is 461, a net loss of 9, which we see in column 6, which is the unreconciled difference between the two counts. Also notice that the preschool special education category has a net gain of 3, the 4K category has a net loss of 1, the 5K category has a net gain of 2, and grades 1 to 12 has a net loss of 13. Again, our mission is to identify the students that are causing the differences between the counts in these categories. So similar to the methodology presented in the first video, the first two reports we will run from our system are to gather the new enrollee and the early withdrawal information. This is a list of resident students enrolling after the third Friday in September, and another list of resident students that were enrolled prior to or on the third Friday in September, but withdrawing before the second Friday in January. To keep things easy, I will actually use the same report I used in the first video, and we see that on the screen right now. So I will go back and add the information. We had two additions in the preschool special education, and we had one addition in the 5K, and we had 15 withdrawals in the grades 1 to 12. So notice that this time, after I entered my new enrollees' early withdrawals, I did not arrive at 0 in all categories or in the grand total. So if your reconciliation is not cleared up by the new enrollees' withdrawals report, you'll need to keep researching the details and know that this may take a little bit of time. So let's focus one by one on the categories that still have differences. So I did a little bit of investigating in the preschool category, and I found out that two students, twins, brother and sister, John and Aaron Smith, were enrolled and receiving services in September on the count date, but they were not yet 3 on the September count date. My district was serving them, and I looked back at my September count, and I discovered that I correctly did not include them in the September count because they were not yet 3 on the September count date. The September count is right. The additional details I found out were their birthday was in December, they were enrolled in receiving services on the January count date, and they were correctly included in the preschool January count. Sometimes there are just a lot of details to gather to know what to do for one reconciliation situation. Okay, so these two would not have been on the new enrollee list because they were enrolled in receiving services at the beginning of school. It was just an age thing where they weren't counted in September. So now they're age eligible, they can be counted. So for these students, putting 2 in the additions column does reconcile the changes that they caused. So I will actually change this to a formula because I'm starting to add different kinds of data to this field, and I want to keep straight what's behind that 4 that we are seeing right now. What you might also want to do is add a comment box. And I know this is not feasible for larger districts. You'll have to find a way to keep a list of the changes that you are putting in the additions column. But at least you see the idea, the rationale, and sort of what we're getting at by adding students to this addition column. So you see, I added two that was from my new enrollment list. And now I added two more, Aaron and John Smith, because I found out that they turned three in December. And that will reconcile the discrepancies that those two were causing. Okay, so while I was looking at the preschoolers and the birth dates in situation one, I noticed that one of the new enrollees, Sandy Souther, was not three on the January count list. But our district was serving her. Sometimes districts serve kids that are not 3 years old only because of their needs. It's a local decision. So I checked the January count, and I did not find her in the January count, which was correct because I found out she was not three on the January count. So she was not included in the September count, and she was not included in the January count. The critical piece of information here is that she was on the new enrollee list, and I added her to the reconciliation based on that information. The new enrollee report lists everyone that has enrolled since the third Friday, but it doesn't check for birth dates or eligibility for a program. So as far as the reconciliation is concerned, she was not counted in either count, so she cannot be included in the additions column explaining a reconciliation difference because she didn't cause a reconciliation difference. So I'm going to actually back her out of that additions column and add her comment minus Sandy Souther from the new enrollee list, because I found out that she was not three yet, even in the January count date. So now, if you look at the difference in column six for this category, I'm at zero, and if there are no other situations for preschoolers that I sort of know about, I'm done with this category. So the membership tip here is that membership is based on enrollment, attendance, and the counting rules. The districts will need to find a system to check birth dates and age requirements of the programs and the students. So having no more reconciliation needed for the preschool special education category, I move on to the 4K, and I see that I have a loss of one student. I remember that there were no changes in this program from the new enrollee early withdrawal list, so I have to do a little bit more digging. I may have to ask the secretary or ask around of people that have access to student records. And I did find out that five-year-old Johnny Miller was placed in a 4K program at the beginning of school because he needed a bit more development before entering the 5K program. He was enrolled and attending from the start of the year, and in September, he was reported in the 4K program. Sometime during the fall semester, the decision was for him to move to the 5K program. This is a situation where a student moves mid-year from one program to another. So I go to my reconciliation. He is no longer included in the 4K. He's a subtraction to the 4K program, and he's an addition to the 5K. So again, I need to sort of turn this into a formula so that I don't lose track of what's going on in the underlying categories. So now when I look at the difference column, not only have I cleaned up the 4K, I've cleaned up the 5K difference. So if I know, again, if I know of no other situations, I am reconciled and I can move on to the grades 1 to 12 category. So in the grades 1 to 12, I find out that there's a sixth grade student, let's call him Stephen King. He was open enrollment in September, which means he was a non-resident in September, and he moved into the district sometime after the September count. He became a resident. This is also tricky because he was enrolled all along. He wouldn't have appeared on the new enrollee list. He would not have been counted in September, but he would have been in January. So by entering a 1 in the additions column in grades 1 to 12, I can capture his reconciliation difference. That explains Stephen King. And then you see I entered information into that bucket. So now we have one student left to reconcile. I found a 12th grade student in the January count, but she wasn't in the September count. Now that really doesn't make sense because I also looked on the new enrollee list. She wasn't there. She wasn't a new open enrollment student. What happened? This really doesn't make sense. Let's call her Heidi. So I asked questions of the student record database administrator or the enrollment secretary, or I looked at her student record trying to find out what happened. And this actually happened to me. And I found out that when school started, even though Heidi was enrolled the whole year, her student record showed an exit date of the previous May. She was a fifth-year senior, but her grad date had not been updated. The school secretary updated the grad date sometime in the first semester, making her an active student. That's why she was on the January count, but not September, because in September she was inactive. In this situation, I found a student that I could have counted in September. So I'm going to go back into my September 1563, I'm going to correct my data, I'm going to submit that report, then return to the reconciliation spreadsheet on the DPI website, and since that reconciliation spreadsheet is live loaded, I should see now a 400 in that bucket, and I added her comment to explain her situation. Now, because this is a new spreadsheet, you're going to have to add all your comments and all your previous additions and subtractions that you've done. But since you've very recently found those out, it's just a clerical task to go ahead and update this spreadsheet to keep track of everything. So the data processing tip here is you probably would have caught this in a smaller district where sort of people know details about kids. But for larger districts, if your system cannot produce a chronological list of changes made to the student record or the student profile, the registrar should somehow keep a manual list of changes or a log of changes, because you will eventually need to get at that log to explain things in your reconciliation. So now our difference column has zeros in all the categories and in the grand total. So I can move on to my closing comments. Our examples were pretty straightforward and not meant to be all-encompassing by any means. You might certainly find other unique situations not mentioned here. In fact, one comes to mind that I ran into, a student name change. And if you really get stuck, you might need to examine all the individual student records for a specific program to get the whole story. Another piece of information is that some software programs have reports tacked on to the end of each 1563, the September and the January, that highlight anomalies in the student record itself. For instance, I've seen errors print out the student name and then something like, the student enrollment status is non-resident enrolled in, but the residency status is set to yes. Well, that doesn't make sense. If the student is a non-resident enrolled in, but their residency status is yes, one of those two is wrong. Something is not right. So if you see these errors in the individual September and January reports, clean it up at that time, because you will need for all the data to have been correctly entered for your reconciliation process. The system can also produce reports of students by some identifying characteristic, such as all open enrollment in or open enrollment out students. Utilize anything you can to verify your counts. And then finally, this can be time consuming. Plan ahead, allot plenty of time to do this reconciliation report, and always please contact a school financial services consultant if you have questions.